just want to call me. So I'll be on the phone as well. I'll be ready if there's anything.
By the library, so if anybody's interested in streaming their content, they can go visit the Blackboard library and have it automatically attached to their Blackboard site in class. And I'm putting this up, which is a back channel, it's called, where you can have a live discussion while something else is happening. And please feel free, please play with your phones the entire time. And please share with us what you're finding on your phones in real time so we can check it out, see what's happening, and learn from one another. And again, my name is Laura March. I work for the Center for Teaching, Research, and Learning, and I'd much rather have a conversation than me just talking to you in a real conversation. So please just stop me if any questions. And hopefully we'll have enough space for anybody to share what they know, and hopefully all of us can learn some cool apps. Yeah, come on in. I'm sorry you missed the music beforehand.
I wasn't really paying attention to the music except that it was on. Mm-hmm. What exactly was the value of that?
Just setting
program?
A tone, to be honest.
No, but it's a program, so I could go into Pandora and call up my Pandora playlist and have it in the background. What's different about
Pandora versus something else?
Panoptic or whatever that was.
Oh, the Panopto?
Yeah.
So Panopto is actually a video recording app.
Okay.
And that can either go through a webcam or a little thing. And so you can use that for either online lectures that moves right into Blackboard. I would honestly suggest going straight to YouTube. You can record directly from your browser into YouTube and make a private video if that's something you're interested in, but it's not fully supported by the library. Panopto is the only one that's fully supported by American. Although if you feel comfortable enough Googling things and how to, I'd suggest YouTube is the way to go with making your own videos.
Mm-hmm.
And the CTRL could also help you a little bit with how we use YouTube, if you're interested in that, or Google Drive, or really any of these mobile apps. But we're not fully supported. Not 24 hours can help you right away on some of the emerging technology. The music itself was just
I wasn't sure when you were clicking it off, which one you were clicking on and
what it's doing. Right, so here I can actually bring up that again. It's called Panopto, and you have to, it's kind of old school. And you can see it's recording everything that's on the screen. You see that kind of Alice in Wonderland tunnel vision? So it takes a little bit in setup, but the library can help you out with that too. I hit that record button, and it's just recording everything going on.
So it's recording this that you're doing right now.
Right. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And bringing up the poll everywhere. That's the back channel discussion where you can either text here to that specific number, put this other code number in your message. It'll show up there. You can tweet to @poll4641160. Or go to pulllove.com/CTRL and use that way. So I'm waiting for you guys to chime in. This is for my last session.
Why do you have to put the 41160 if you're texting
poll number? Because you can have multiple polls per class.
Oh, so it's responding
for a specific poll. So you can even do multiple choice things. We'll see some of that stuff later.
Okay.
But this is just the first one. So, hello, everybody that's coming in. I'm Laura March, and I really do want this to be a conversation, so keep asking me questions, keep on telling me, no, that's wrong, this is better, because it's all of us learning in it together. I guess as we start, I'd want to call out Lucas Regner right behind you, who's in charge of our mobile learning initiative, and he can help you with anything that you're interested in using with mobile technology in your classroom this semester or next semester. So if you see any of these tools that you really like, ask Regner. He can hopefully get you some funding, some time, really be your guide. Do you want to speak about the initiative at all?
No, it's just that if you have an idea about how you would like to incorporate any mobile technology into the courses you're teaching, we're up for anything. So we can help with figuring out how you would do that the best way, what apps might be the best way of doing it, if it's an app, how you potentially should restructure or change stuff in your syllabus to accommodate for that particular component, etc. It's a pretty open-ended thing. So you gotta just have an idea, and then we can try to help you develop it and see if we can kind of.
And so this session itself is part of the mobile initiative. And we also created a database of the apps currently being used on campus and would love your help trying to flesh it out so you can share your experiences with other people in the university community. If you're interested in providing a review, it's pretty quick. It's just like a Google form sheet. If you wouldn't mind signing up near the computer, it's this one with this. The only paper thing, hopefully, we'll be doing today. And we would really love your input on whatever apps you're using, what apps you've tried to use and was a disgrace, so you'd recommend other instructors just staying away from. We'd love that information to put it up on our CTRL blog. Great. So I was wondering, even before we get started, if we wouldn't mind going around and sharing maybe our names and what interests you about mobile technology. I'm Laura March, and it's my job to be interested about this stuff. No, I'm really, my thesis research in graduate school was about social media and grassroots activism. And at Penn State, we're able to do a lot of like kind of rapid response programming from the sex abuse scandal that happened a few years ago. And together with my now husband, we raised about $126,000 within a week just using social media. So that's what got me interested in kind of mobile technology. If you wouldn't mind starting.
Laurie Frank, I feel I should be interested in this, but I'm not sure why. I'm not sure how I really could use it without it being more of a distraction than a plus for class. So I'm kind of just here to learn what other people are doing and how I might apply it in my course.
Wonderful.
What course do you teach?
I'm Carol Brown. I'm art history, and we tend to appear old school, and I think that it would be good for us to embrace this because I think it would make art more exciting and accessible.
Wonderful.
Steve Delzone, SIS, and I'm kind of with Larry, and they're kind of the, you know, I don't know what I don't know that I could be using, so I'm here just to get smarter on that.
Do you want to introduce yourself again, Michael?
Yes, I moved in and started 2 months ago at CTRL, and I am just tasked with doing fun things with you all and trying to figure out new and unique ways that we can use technology in teaching, but not just for the sake of technology, but for the sake of actually achieving learning objectives that we can't really achieve in other ways and other assessment pressures that we already have enhanced. So that's what I'm supposed to do. And mobile technology specifically, I'm still unsure, and I'm exploring this with every new course I come across to see if there's ways that we can deliver it in a smart way, incorporate it so it actually makes sense for learning the course.
Joseph Mortati with CODA. I teach information systems, and one thing I haven't used very well is things like this in the classroom to model good behavior, or at least show the students what technologies available in the business, but to bring it to the classroom. So I'm really interested in what you have to say.
I'm Collette O'Chef, and I also like to. I just get a lot of questions about this one.
Maybe all the way in the back?
Oh, yes. Yeah. I'm Meredith Anderson, School of Public Affairs, and I teach race and policy courses in general public policy. And I'm really interested in this. We use poll everywhere in our previous position. I was in the school district, and we kind of used it to poll district leaders about what they were thinking. Meeting to kind of have them think. So I'm interested in kind of using it in the classroom to maybe spur conversation.
Have you added anything on there? We'll wait for it. Okay.
I got my smartphone maybe not so long ago, but I find I'm looking at it all the time, so every day, so from day to evening, so I hope like, that there are some interesting applications to teach you.
I know my name and world language, and I teach Spanish, and I use some on my own with Instagram pictures and phrases in there with one glass as a try out, and it worked pretty good. But I would like to know how to do more of the other. I've been trying here, but you know, there's a lot of stuff that I don't know. But I think it's really good for languages. It's really
useful.
Right? Pandor Lee at Corbus for Business. I teach information systems. I've been using Facebook for class discussion, and also I started using the Core Everywhere last year to engage students, and then I have to learn more, you know, the new and creative ways of using technology to engage students.
Great.
So my name is Susan Krish. I'm also with COCOT, and I'm here more or less to find out what some of the tools are that I could consider.
Wonderful. So if you guys have already used Poll Everywhere, please take out your phones. I want to see everybody on their phones the whole time, honestly, and just start showing it up there so everybody can see what the process was like. You can either text that number plus this code word in the message. You could tweet at this Twitter handle, or go to pollev.com/CTRL and submit something. Really, just test it out. Tell me how it goes, and we'll see what happens. How about the people that have already used Poll Everywhere too? Did you find it being a positive experience, or that it detracted or took away from?
I had a very positive response from students at the beginning, but as I used the tool over and over again, they a little bit got tired of it. I mean, it was pretty poor at the beginning, but how to keep engaged in a pretty way. But it was pretty effective at the beginning.
They dropped off. How about at the school district?
We used it just, and I was the one that said that's why I'm interested.
Oh, okay.
But I think it was a good idea because we're making a lot of high-stakes decisions and needed impact and decisions quickly.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was a really good way to get feedback without getting other people's opinions to kind of block your own viewpoint.
Wonderful. So I guess without further ado, let's just start in.
I went to the website, and then I don't have to log in or anything, do I?
Nope.
I just posted it.
Mm-hmm. And see, did it come up here? Is it one of these?
No.
And you hit submit
already? Yeah, that's good.
Wonderful. It worked. So how was that experience? People that had never done that before, was that difficult? Was that, I don't know, a bit terrifying to have your personal phone go and be public?
So is it aggregating based on the text number, the 41106?
Mm-hmm. And I just had it set to random for it to pull and move around to be bigger or smaller. You can set it to be.
And how frequently can you change that number, like every class? Like every class related to
public? Yeah. You can do it within different slides. So there's actually a thing that you can download with PowerPoint.
Uh-huh.
So with different slides, it could be different polls. And then it would change.
Well, I don't
have
that part, but.
Yeah.
But I like this idea.
Yeah, yeah.
So how's the number generated then?
It's just automatic. You can pay, and it'll allow you to make a custom. But this is the free version. Yes?
So at the bottom of the screen, it says, CTRL cannot give you credit for your responses unless you register with them.
Right, so if you want your students to be able to see which student said something, then you'd have to pay the $5 for the like first tier. But without logging in, you can get these kind of anonymous questions. And they're different. Does anybody do any anonymous discussion boards versus... there are different pros and cons with that, that you can have questions people might be embarrassed about, or that you feel that your prejudice about the topic might influence their grade, or they feel that your prejudice would influence their grade, so that's the reason to do anonymous versus non. Also, it's free to have it be anonymous versus the first tier of how I'm doing.
Can this be stored?
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. And it goes into a pretty cool... well, actually, I'll have slides on that later, so we can actually go into the deep into the back. Yeah. All great questions. Mm-hmm.
I don't think anything in finance that real sensitive, but I do think anonymous. What do I ask students to do? What do I want from this?
What was your favorite part about the reading? And then if you have a class of 200 people, you can like actually see if something becomes bigger. Mm-hmm. Or you could even do maybe a multiple choice question. And
that's
what
I do all the time. So
yeah.
In class or out of class?
In class.
Mm-hmm.
So if there is some discussion point you have there, and then you still could start to have some pick poll from students, whether they are for or against, or yes or no, and then we can
Yeah, kind of the like think, pair, share on a big screen.
I like to think pair share, and I started integrating my classes. And I used, I think it's Polaris, it's whatever Scott Callum uses, he recommended. What I found was, on the one hand, if I use this, it's kind of cumbersome. On the other hand, if they have clickers, I know they're all going to forget their clickers,
yeah,
and I'm not going to have them. So I'd like to have that sort of instantaneous think, pair, share feedback, but basically I found that I still have people raise their hands, because no technology is really better than just, you know, A, B, or C.
Yeah.
It's quick, it's simple, and I mean, I can't tabulate this information, but I don't care about tabulating.
I mean, it'd definitely be good for that high research and high impact research to be at lunch, right? So you can keep track of everything.
Yeah,
for the peer-reviewed journal article on A, B, or C. But again, it really is what works for you, and I'd love to have your review of the app that you used up, so other professors can think about it, or please do. So the way I guess I approached it was looking at different functions, and then finding apps that best fulfill those functions, whether they were Android or iOS. So unfortunately, we really only have iOS here. That's the same with 96% of your students will have iOS devices, for meaning the Apple iPhones. But there are many, many other Android apps. Usually developers will make an app for the iOS operating system first, and then go back into Android, and it's a marketing decision, because the people with iPhones have the money to spend on an app. That's what it comes down to for us. So with all that being said, sorry.
I thought it was a technology issue, actually, because the iPhone has one operating system, whereas Android, even if it's a Droid, there are multiple versions. That would change the way the app works.
Yeah, that's okay.
Not just, you know, version 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, but different operating systems across.
Yes, definitely. And we get into that when you're looking at the device options that you can set your phones to do. So when you're telling somebody you want your flashlight to go on the iOS system, it's one place where the flashlight button is. On Android, it could be in a lot of different folders in many different places. But Android users have a lot more freedom, and the developers have a lot more freedom on what they can do, and they don't necessarily have to be approved by a kind of nebulous, all-knowing board at Apple that says, no, you're not allowed to do that type of content on our phone. So there really is a lot of pros and cons about if you're interested in developing your own app, which way you'd want to go first versus Android versus iOS. So again, I'd love to hear your thoughts, too. Keep going over here. And if there's something big enough, just be like, Laura, stop. Everybody's saying the opposite. Please keep going.
I always felt that any app I used had to be available on both systems, but I couldn't say, this intro finance is only for Apple users, or, we'll leave some off. So that's why the Pull Everywhere, one of the reasons I think that's one I chose, was it was really device or operating system free. There aren't that many things that you can find that are both Android, laptop/desktop, and iOS.
And the two that you're going to have some different choices with is the Whiteboard app and the Attendance app. And it's interesting that the Attendance has something it's almost exactly the same, except it's a copycat on the Android version, but the Android version has a lot more like interesting, I guess, surprises through it too. But beyond that, you know, I'll have options for both of those, and we'll go through that. Is there anything beyond here that you guys are really interested in learning about, that we can look for other apps that fulfill a type of function that other professors might be interested in? Great. Well, here are my choices. For the QR codes, there's the best-selling app is called QR Reader. For PDF scanning, there's Scanner Pro, which is currently on sale for $3, but there's a Scanner Mini that's free. You can test out, see if it's worth the $3. It's usually $10, so if you can test that out now and actually buy it.
What does it do exactly?
You take pictures of your... I'll go through that, too, later on. You can actually take pictures of... this, a written piece of paper, and save it as PDFs, multiple pages, and then email them, fax them. So you make a PDF.
Are
out of
your
that.
Slides going to be on the Blackboard site?
Yeah, I can send them out via email to everybody if that works. Yeah.
Sure.
Great. So let's.
You actually had a URL on the first page. Is it there as well?
Yeah. If you want to follow along, the whole entire presentation is on Google Drive. And you can get that at bit.ly/mobile-toolkit. And follow along with me. So that QR, let's start with the custom options. Is everybody familiar with this Command Center screen or the Android version over here? Command Center is something that happened with iOS 7, the second to last update, where you can even pull something up from the bottom of the screen and get a whole bunch of options, which is pretty cool. I'm a huge believer in customizing your own device, so these can show a little bit more of your customization with turning the wireless and airplane and screen brightness and everything on there. And you don't even have to unlock your phone, so you don't have to put your fingerprint or your password in to get to this. So if you lose your earring back under your bed, that definitely didn't happen to me last night. You can just click on your flashlight and check it out real quick without having to put in your password beforehand. Is anybody completely against upgrading their phone? Do we have anybody that would hate to make the move over to iOS 7 yet? Okay, because that happened last time. Like, that's not worth it. but I must say that you should be upgrading your phone specifically for security reasons.
So how do I actually tell what system I'm on?
Do you remember which iPhone version you're on?
Android.
That should be in the settings, which would look different on every device, unfortunately. So this is how their versions look. So you can see that this has multiple screens for some of the same sorts of settings. And what I really recommend doing there, if you want to do something specific like the accessibility personalization, is Google the name of your phone. So Droid Nexus 7, or was it Razer? What was it?
Droid Razer,
and adjust screen brightness. And usually the first result from Google will give you a how-to of adjusting that. For iOS, I highly suggest adjusting the screen, the text size, because the median age of starting to have your eyesight degenerate is 36 and a half. And these little screens really do have an impact on what you're doing physically with yourself. Does anybody make that change in their own device? Has anybody done that?
Laptop.
That? What do you think?
It makes a big difference.
Yeah?
Difficult to get used to it though.
Yeah?
Because it comes up and all of a sudden I think I'm looking at cartoon text.
Yeah. There's also a lot of other options that you can do if you have any physical or motor ability, like setting the home screen button to like a less rapidness to change things on. If you're feeling that you're unable to touch things with the amount of speed that the device has automatically. Those are all within your settings, and whether that's Android or iOS, both can do this. And I'm sure any modern device can do a lot of these accessibility settings. How about this? Does anybody use the auto lock and rotation up there? So when you don't want to have your screen flip, when have you used that?
Well, reading books.
Yeah.
Sometimes I'll
sleep on the side. I've done that while watching movies. Mm-hmm. How about the Do Not Disturb? Has anybody used that yet? Oh, wow. So it's a little night here. I believe it's the blocking mode over there for Android. But putting on that Do Not Disturb, you can set this also in the settings area within your screen. It'll make your calls go straight to voicemail, your text message alerts go off. It'll make your any sounds that your phones make, just stop them for as long as you'd like. So if you're using your device while you're in class, you probably want to put on a Do Not Disturb on your phone. And I have a good friend that does it every night from 9 at night to 6 in the morning, and you can schedule that in your phone as well, so that you just don't receive any phone calls or texts. It does have something where you can allow emergency calls. So if somebody calls twice within 3 minutes, it'll let the second one through. And that could be an option if it's something that's worrying you, if you want to the is to have people write, get in touch with you really quickly. So to set your mind at ease about that. There's stuff with like automatic subtitles. You can get LED flash for alerts if your hearing isn't as good as you want it to be. You can just do that because it looks cool. When it comes, the LED flashing looks nice.
I can't find the text size one on mine, but maybe because I have a 3. Is it the later edition, you know? Or
for an iPhone, for iPhone, the 3?
Yeah.
You know, this might be because I got really... okay. Apple got chewed out because they didn't have this.
Oh, okay.
And they were really ahead of the game until kind of, I want to say 2003, 2005, and then Windows really took over. But now they're coming back, so they're offering all this. So as far as the actual apps themselves, and this is QR Reader. Feel free to download them while we're chatting. Does everybody have a login? Can you reach the wireless if that's something you want to do now? Okay. So my favorite is QR Reader because it's the most popular, and that means it has the least amount of bugs, at least for now. It's available both on iTunes and Google Play. There are some banner ads on it, but you can just click out of them usually or pay the 99 cent upcharge to get rid of all banner ads. There's also a default one on most Droids, so I'm not sure if does anybody have a Droid with them that can double check that for me? That there's another QR code scanner within it. I think it's in the Google Now app. And there's also a scanner within the iPhone Passbook. But that doesn't work for anything that's not really commercial. So it'll work for your Starbucks cards or your plane tickets, but it won't really work for museum information if you want to see something like that. And we can come back to the history of QR codes, which are really just
there's
a kind of
QR
code.
That
must be it. Okay. And there are a whole lot of other similar technologies being developed, like near-field communications and some visual recognition stuff that's coming out, so it's really exciting to see what will happen next.
How do you use these in the context of a class or education?
I'm glad you asked that. How could this be useful to professors? They can be used on paper syllabi to link to specific things, like a calendar event for your final or contact info if you want specific emails for you to be used. And it would move directly from the physical world into the virtual world in their phone. But remember that it is a phone that people are usually using. So if you want them to be reading long articles, it probably wouldn't be best as a QR code to link them directly to that text. It could also be kind of a quick reference thing. So one professor actually makes a website or makes text of correct answers to quizzes and prints out that QR code, puts it on the outside of their door after a test, so students as they're leaving can take the QR code, see all the correct answers immediately, and like the privacy of their own device, and they're not going to come back in and say, look at my phone, and here you go, because it gives that immediate feedback. So there are also tons of other examples online. I think there's here. Yeah, 50 great ways to use QR codes in a college classroom, so that'll be in the same slide you can click on to. And to make a QR itself, you can use these two websites or find anything else. QR generators is just the Google search term you go for. You can copy and paste those images right into your syllabus. You can create it and then print it if that's something you're interested on using for a test day.
If I put a QR code big on a PowerPoint slide.
Mm-hmm.
Would students be able to
snap
it with their phone? If I did like that, mm-hmm. and I snap that with my phone, would it work?
We'll try it. Want to?
Well, I don't have a QR reader on.
Oh, okay, let's see. I've been able to do it on screen, but I'm sorry that this will probably not be good because it'll have too many of these at once. I don't know, let's check it out. Is it confusing the lens? Too much? Do you have to hold up to it closely?
I have a feeling it might be, if there's only one on there, it would be here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How about,
I think rather than putting a website, you could put the website, but also mm-hmm. put a QR code, mm-hmm. and they could just snap with their phone.
Oh yeah, that would definitely be a great way. Let's try it. I've definitely done it on my computer, if I stand away from the slide and make sure that it works correctly. Mm-hmm. And this is something we can test out after. Edit the slides and make it work. Has anybody used QR codes themselves, or have done them for making a plane ticket or that sort of option? Yeah, a couple here and there. I especially like it for savings cards at groceries or the like customer rewards cards. I just add them all to my phone, and so when you check out, you can just show them the phone instead of having to dig through your wallet for all those tiny keychain cards.
Because essentially, what it is, just it creates a link to anywhere on the web, right? That's sort of, and so that's sort of, anything you potentially could do with that can be done through a QR code. Right?
You bet, yeah.
So then that's really, so in any situation where you would want people to very quickly access a website or any content on the web, but exactly, it's not through, they're not seeing this link to a website. Probably the best way to go about it, right?
Okay.
So I don't maintain my own website. What happens if I have a file on Blackboard
that's
with a QR code?
Well, what they would probably be taken to is the login info for your Blackboard site, if that makes sense, because they'll have to like log in through their phone to get into Blackboard. If they're already logged in, then it'll come in to whatever that link is.
But then, if it comes to the login site, the next thing that they see,
that would depend on Blackboard. Sometimes it only takes you straight to the page that your content is on. So you can, if you have a page in Blackboard that's like a web link, a PDF, and a video link, I don't think it'll go into the sublinks. I think it'll just go to the long page with all those things listed. But if it's a link on the web that's not through your Blackboard page.
Like I said, I don't maintain my own website. And, okay. And so, tell me that the university will allow me to do that through their server.
Well, we actually have a pilot project in the works if you're interested. You can come chat with me later. It's a WordPress installation that you're more than welcome to use. But also, it doesn't have to necessarily be on the web. It could just be plain text, or it could be a map location that sends it to the phone's default map app, or a text message. So you could have something all filled out that a student could text you back if you'd like, or again, a calendar event. So it's really whatever. I think it's a couple thousand characters if it's in plain text that you can have in that one fun looking bar. You hold your phone with a QR code up on it, and just like you've been seeing people here, hold it at the QR code, hover it, and it'll pop up immediately with whatever information is encoded within that barcode. Any more questions? Checking out here, is there anything happening with the QR code?
How do you actually create the code yourself?
That's a good question. You can go to the QR code generator, okay. And I put those links below here, goqr.me. It'll make a JPEG or a PNG file that you can save to your computer or your whatever device you're using, and you can insert it straight into a Word document. You can upload it if you have your own web page, which you will in the future. And that's how people mostly do them. If you prefer to use a different service, there are lots out there for making your QR codes. And they can be in color, they can put those fun images on the inside. It just depends on how much work you want to put into it on your end of making them. Anything else? Let's go over to PDF scanning. And this has actually changed since the last time this session happened. The CAM scanner came out, which was a lot better than the previous default PDF maker. So, and QR Reader has, if you download that app, it has a PDF scanner within it as well. But it's kind of fuzzy, and it doesn't have all the bells and whistles that these other two. So that's why I continued to add another. Sorry to clutter up your screen. Does anybody else have another PDF scanning app that they like? Yeah.
Tiny scan. I'm not real happy with it, so I'm not recommending it.
So what weren't you happy with?
Elementary, but I'll like scan several, mm-hmm. And I'll find just the most recent one. It's hard to find, like, I've got several documents in there. The document retrieval is not as user-friendly as I would like it to be.
Right. Well, the one that I love is the Scanner Pro, and again, it's half off right now, $3. Uh-huh. It'll upload straight to your Dropbox, Google Drive, or Skybox immediately. So then it'll save everything for you, and that's great for a clutter, or a digital hoarder, right? Is that what we're called?
Would you expand on that a little bit? You said it does it automatically. What if you've got multiple places? Does it give you the option? I mean, for example, I could see doing something in class, like taking my notes or something like that, saving it as a PDF off the screen,
mm-hmm.
and then it automatically going to someplace.
Mm-hmm.
Can you set it to go to Blackboard, or would it have to be Google Docs?
You'd probably have to save it in your computer or your laptop or whatever you're using, and then go into Blackboard and hit upload from that. And that's that would actually be great for a whiteboard app, which also saves as a PDF. If you want to use your iPad or your phone as a whiteboard, and then save it, and then it can send directly to you via email or a couple other options too. This one is like if you have papers on the fly, or if you're asking your students to give you printed out papers, and you want to do multiple pages, and Cam Scanner, the one for Android. Even lets you do the text recognition, so you can use your phone scanner to take a picture of this, do the text recognition, and then go in there and edit it later, too, which is pretty awesome. I don't know if you guys have ever gotten PDFs where you can't copy any paste or anything like that. So that kind of takes care of it. And that's actually an accessibility thing. So people with screen readers that don't interact with screens, they have a robot talk to them and tell them what's on the screen. You need to have that text recognized. And it's a setting we can help you out with CTRL and finding and making sure that all of your PDFs are accessible for people using screen readers.
So what's the main difference between the scanner, the mini,
mm-hmm.
and the Pro?
I'm glad you asked. So the mini is a free version, and the way that it syncs is when you sync your iPhone or, this actually is only for iPhones, to your computer, so when you plug it in via USB, then all of your PDFs go into iTunes and onto your computer. The Pro version for $3 allows you to straight up email them, text them. Let's see, I think I have a whole list. Adjust the size document and EndNote, SkyDrive, all of the other ways that you could potentially send it out to yourself or to other people instead of having to sync it with a cord to your device. Mm-hmm.
I just thought of a Scanner Pro. One of the nice things is you can set it so that it automatically sets its frame around the document,
mm-hmm.
as opposed to getting the piece of paper with a pencil next to it and an eraser on the other side. You can set it so it knows what the words of the document are, and all you get in the PDF is the document, not what's beside it.
Definitely. And that you can kind of see that over on that screenshot over there. It kind of automatically finds it for you, but you can also adjust it if it's not picking up the right thing, so you don't get the corners of the other one or barcode or the table. I mean, I'm sure you've experienced those very poorly scanned PDFs with half of another page on it, that sort of stuff. And you can easily change it into black and white, which makes it a little bit smaller of a file, and have multiple pages, and you can delete them or rearrange them. And that little button, which everybody should be familiar with, is the like send it somewhere else. Hit that when you have the full version, send it to your email, send it to Dropbox, send it to Gmail, right from the app. It's really good for scanning, for faxing too. It was about, I think $2 gets you 4 pages of scans, and at FedEx it's $2 per page, so. It's a quarter of the price to fax something from your phone and having to drive to UPS or FedEx. Anybody else use fax from their phone with apps? I had to do it from a doctor's office once. Like, why can't I just email it? Really? What am I doing this faxing? So talking about whiteboards and actually doing notes in class, has anybody been in a classroom yet that does not have a chalkboard or a whiteboard? Haven't had that privilege yet? Well, even if they don't have those, they will have projectors. So you can plug in your iPad, your iPhone, your computer, and just take notes on that. And the two apps that I like best are Mighty Meeting, which is either Android or iOS, or Edgy Creations, which is just iOS. Mighty Meeting is interesting. You have to first go into mightymeeting.com and create your account, and that will give you a room ID, which you can send out to all of your students. And then, let's take a look at it more. So you can either send that out to your students, which is called a broadcast, or use the Nearcast, so anybody, any of your students that are already logged in will have that PDF or meeting or PowerPoint even sent out to their phone, anybody nearby that's within the app. It really just depends on you. I think that's pretty cool. You don't even have to have internet for that. So once they join that room or have it pushed out to their app, you can flip through the pages and it'll flip through the pages automatically on their device. You or students could start drawing on the device itself, and those annotations will show up in the final version that can get emailed out to everybody afterwards as well.
Does the audience have to register with the site as well?
They might have to. I haven't done it from the student side yet, but if you want to test it out, I could pretend to be a student.
This might be slightly off topic, but do you know if the Blackboard company is planning on integrating? Seems like these people are stealing their business.
Right.
And you would think that they would be at the forefront since there are so many different university campuses.
Well, I haven't heard of anything specifically about Whiteboard things, but we will be upgrading 5 years of versions within the next year at AU. So we're going from Blackboard 9 right now to Blackboard 14, hopefully over winter break. And hopefully there'll be some big updates then where they're getting us back into, 2014. So we'll keep fingers crossed for that. So this is the Mighty Meeting version. EduCreations goes one step further, and it lets you record everything as it's happening, and including audio as well. So you can be speaking and using your stylus to create things and point things out, talking over it, and it'll save that whole thing as like a little movie. So students can go back and check the workout again and do lectures over and over again. You can preload those images, you can preload PDFs, and then go through it, and really the neatest part about it is that you can capture your voice at the same time. And there's 100 and, let me get this right because it seems crazy. Yeah, 150,000 EduCreations already created here of the feature lessons. And so if you need to get advice on how to teach, functions or how volcanoes work, you can watch other people as they're actually doing it on there, or send those out to your students if you'd like. And they can access that through a web browser or the app. I don't think they need to even download the app to access it through their web browser, those sorts of lessons. Any other questions on this? We can test these all out too. I'll just leave these open for everybody to test out.
Now this is iOS only.
This is iOS only, unfortunately.
But if they could do it through a web browser, then anyone could
right.
at least watch it.
They could watch it, but they couldn't create it themselves. Yeah.
There's a paid version which exists for Android, which is called Explain Everything, and it's like $2. But that one they could put from iOS.
And I've also seen a lot of instructors use this for final projects. So if you need students to really explain something to you and you don't want them to do it in class, you can ask them to do a sort of video lecture like this and grade it on your own term. You don't have to take class time and doing final presentations in front of everybody.
Or if someone was sick on the final exam day and they were supposed to give a presentation, they could do it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
A lot of grandmothers die, I hear, around the end of the semester. Great. Checking those out. So let's go on to file management. And I would suggest Google Drive for both iOS and Android devices. And here's my big public service announcement, which is to save your content in 3 separate places. The big stuff. You've got to have it in multiple areas just in case the sky collapses. Your phone catches on fire. That happened last week. Somebody's Samsung caught on fire. Don't know. One of those should be locally in your computer or laptop on the hard drive. The second should be a hard or an external backup, so a little C disk, multiple USB drives, if external somewhere. And the third should be on the cloud, so you can access that anywhere. But don't just keep stuff on the cloud, especially grades and like stuff you really, really need to have. Keep it 3 places. So that being said, why did I choose Dropbox over Drive? And to be honest,
you chose Dropbox over Drive.
Oh, sorry, I don't drive over Dropbox. There you go. Sorry, it's been a long day. Well, does anybody have any thoughts there before I go into mine? I use both, to be honest, but.
I like Dropbox.
Yeah? It does? Have you done sort of collaborative things on Dropbox yet?
I use it for storage, for the other presentation.
Yeah. I use it a lot for different versions of that I'm writing, or if I want to write down something at work, I'm work on it at home as well. But it gets really hairy when you want to share things. So if you have something open and another person tries to open it, it like will write over each other.
That's Dropbox that does
that? That's Dropbox that does that. But it's very easy. Dropbox is super easy. So if you're just doing files that you want to access different locations, go for it. Like, I use it a lot, too. Or if you want to make public links available for people to download. So somebody was doing a video that they didn't want to post on YouTube or anywhere else, that they could make it publicly available for other people to download, but not anybody to watch on their own, on the internet, on the greater internet, if you will. Also, it's a little bit cheaper. So you get 5 gigs for free. Dropbox, you get 2. If you want to upgrade your plan, it's $5 for 100 gig on Drive and $10 for 100 gig on Dropbox. And there are
for a year.
Mm-hmm. So the types of documents that you can actually edit in Google Drive look like Word, Excel, PowerPoint, but it's really just a function of what they are. So they are PowerPoint files. This isn't a PowerPoint, it's a Google presentation. And you can also do any other type of file. It just won't edit it within the internet browser itself. You have to download it each time. So specialized files like Photoshop or Illustrator or even Final Cut Pro files that are large and you want to save, you can do it. You just won't be able to edit your Final Cut Pro within your Firefox browser. anybody have any experience with that? With editing files on Google versus was it pretty easy or?
Well, you know, sometimes I find it difficult to convince like co-authors, especially we have four co-authors, right?
Mm-hmm.
They have a very different, you know, preference in terms of how you want to take turns for them to edit papers.
So oh, yeah.
Usually I fail to convince one of them. They have to drop off or email,
mm-hmm.
they take turns rather than co-editing them.
Yeah.
There's one guy who is strongly against it.
We actually did that for our fall newsletter once, is that everybody in our department felt comfortable editing it in Google Docs except for one person. And so then we all finished our edit, gave it to that last person for their last go around. It's a lot easier without having, you know, 15 different versions at once. If you want to play around with this right now and you got your phone open, I made a whole bunch of Google documents for a previous workshop, and you're welcome to take a look about how it works if you want to get in there and try it. But I thought that it would be best to actually show you what it looks like.
This is Google Drive.
It's where I upload and store files.
Like my stories.
My recipes.
My class presentations. My photos.
And my super obsessive spreadsheet.
But Drive is more than just storage.
I can create.
I can share. And we can edit at the same time. So wherever I go, my stuff goes with me.
I've got everything I need.
Whenever I need it.
In Drive.
So that shows how the collaboration actually works in real time. And there's also another cool video about how to access them on different areas. So I'll show you that.
Thank you.
saw, that was our adorable marketing video. But really, there's so much you can do with Google Drive. You can do any sort of collaborative assignments. If you want to have your students work in teams for anything, they're probably already using Google Drive to do at least first drafts. There will be Google Apps workshops at CTRL, that's right across the quad, happening in September and October, and you can register for those here. You can just check out online, thirty. 4.3 million results for how to use Google Drive in classroom. So lots to go on there. So won't spend any more time talking about that, unless you guys have anything else that you want to share or any other questions. Terrific. So this is one of the coolest things that I found in redoing this workshop from the previous one, is teacher's aid, apostrophe S, possessive S, has an awesome copycat now on Android system, just teacher aid. And it does all of the same stuff. You just have to pay for it if you want the full version. The full version means you get, I think, 200 classes with 500 students each. The demo version is just 30 students. That's just for Android. The teacher's aid for iOS is free. I love this because you can really have this clean and intuitive interface that you use for simple tasks, like taking attendance, or seeing your students, so you can see their pictures, and you don't necessarily have to search back for the file sheets of your mind of everybody's name. You can learn that a little bit easier. When you mark students absent, you can send a quick text to all of them saying, you know, what's up, class is starting in 5, I still don't see you. You can call on random students, so you can have the algorithm figure out who's being called next, and it'll make sure to go through everybody once before it restarts. Algorithm and go again for a second batch of questions. And you can also make random groups. So if you find that you want to have 3 people to a group or 4 people to a group, it'll sign it there. You can see the pictures. It's really a terrific app, and it's free to try out on iOS. Any questions on this or ideas on how to use it? Mm-hmm.
So how does it, tell us about how the attendance process works.
Sure. Well, actually, you can take it out and test it on my phone later. You can either put it in manually or use a spreadsheet. And they have a spreadsheet you can download and just edit yourself in there, and put in all that information from their phone numbers, their emails, their pictures. And if you do have a large class, you can just kind of copy and paste from Blackboard into that spreadsheet and upload it onto your phone. It also does... So you would, like, tap on one to say present, and that would be the green, and you can tap twice on another to say late, or 3 times to do absent. Those sort of actions are swipe left and swipe right. You can also do grading on here, although you really should be using Blackboard to be doing grading. But for perhaps participation or other areas, you can just have your phone out to say, you know, yes, that person talked once, yes, that person talked 3 times, and therefore fulfilled the participation of this course. And have that emailed back and forth to you in either HTML or I think that CSV is the format they use for their spreadsheet, which will open on Excel or Mac version of the, I think. Do you ever know what Pages version is?
Numbers?
There you go.
What's the best way to get assuming you think pictures would be useful? Mm-hmm. 35 minutes, for a minute time. How do you
get
pictures on there?
I would suggest asking your students to do them, upload them themselves on a discussion board, and then take them from there. Save it from the discussion board into your own computer, so then they can give a shot that they'd like to do.
Discussion board
on Blackboard, or whatever you use. There's Engage for people teaching only online. Or you can use Facebook or Twitter. We're not going to stop you from doing social media in your classes if you want to do that.
I understand that the YT, the Office of IT, is working to add a feature to Blackboard that includes student picture. There's a lot of information I'm not asking
you
to send pictures that are going to be there. So I think
that
would
be very good.
But there was an issue with the pictures.
Well, we're hoping, so this is in other universities. they have the ID photos in one system and allowing that system to talk to your Blackboard system. And supposedly it's a real big deal, but if they upgrade, you know, 5 years in one semester, I'm hoping it'll be there. I hope so. Cross fingers.
It's supposed to be the summer, so.
So, do you know if you, when you, okay, so regardless of where the pictures are, can you do a bulk upload, or do you have to do...
You might be able to in that spreadsheet.
This is Mary, this is Jane, this is Deuce, this is Samson.
You might have to, I'm sure it'll have some information about on their...
I'm just curious if you need to. I'm going to have over 100 students this fall, and this could be very, this one, this one, this one.
It could also
be would definitely be like through the spreadsheet, right? And so if you have someone's self that they can do in a very quick way, just from downloading the information you have on Blackboard. It would obviously be with the picture still, since I don't think they're into Blackboard. So that would have to be either added manually as the students drop in their send you the pictures and whatnot, or you just wait until they send you all the pictures and then you put the spreadsheet.
And I think you can also do a point and shoot too, so if one of your requirements is office hours, you can do it while they're there, you know, just hit tap and into the face. Or while they're going around introducing themselves, you could say, you know, take a selfie and do it that way. So that, or yeah, you could have no pictures if you don't want to spend the time, or if they still go through it. Terrific. I have it on here all ready to go with some artists if you want to try it out. Virtual computing is a pretty cool thing. It's actually supported by CTRL in the lab right next door to my office. If you like, you can actually use any of the lab computers in that room from anywhere with an internet browser, and you can just tap right into all that power. And to get started, you head to vcl.american.edu. You can do this on your iPhone, your iPad, anything with a browser that you have a URL into. And I suggest just using the virtual desktop if you're not doing anything hardcore. There is SPSS and a couple of other big programs you can use. And then you might want to download the client so it works a little faster. But just select that virtual desktop item. Takes you to a screen. You log into the VCL lab. I always tend to hit log off instead of connect, so just be aware of that. It's in the different area on the screen. And it takes you really just to one of those computers. So my iPad screen looks like this. It looks like a PC. And I can use things like Internet Explorer on my iPad. So if you've got things that you need to do only on Internet Explorer, but you're a Mac person, you'll never be able to do it unless you go through this sort of a system where you tap in and let the computer lab computer come in. It's also useful if students don't have Microsoft Word. So I just, you know, hit that start button like anybody would and select Microsoft Word. And it makes a Word page. And so if you've got students that don't want to pay for Word, if you want to put your track changes document and give it back to them and they say, I can't open this, go to vcl.american.edu and open it through there. A word with saving things, it will really only save to your G or J drive, which is the space that they give you at American University, or you can save it on the desktop and email it to yourself through Firefox. So it's just keep aware that it won't save on your iPad or your machine locally. And it'll time out after 60 minutes. And once it times out, it's just done. Your work is lost. So definitely keep saving. That's something that you want to be doing, especially for those big and really expensive programs like SPSS. If you're using it once in one class, your students can just do it through this. Don't have to spend that huge amount of money on software.
Doesn't actually occupy a physical computer in the lab.
It's actually licensing, so I think there are 150 licenses, right?
Okay.
So
yes, you can run out.
Yeah.
Too many people log on at the same time.
But the lab could be full, and still I could get space.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not actually taking over.
Physical computers. So how many users are on?
Okay. Do you have MATLAB?
Yes.
Yes, on there too.
Mm-hmm. It's on this.
So the licenses, is that for connecting, or is that specific to each software component?
I think it's connecting.
It's connecting. Mm-hmm. Okay. So as soon as we all start using it, we're
going to No, but if we're using it more and more, then that'll just give us more ammunition to buy more licenses.
Okay. We've been buying as much as we can. Okay.
can you check what version of Microsoft files are?
I have no. They get updated. I think it gets updated with whatever the computer labs get updated with. So, did they say that they were going to 2013?
Yes, I logged on now and got 2013.
Perfect. Yeah, I remember getting that email probably after I made this presentation. But that's what's upgraded.
So you can go on your on tablet and get it on there.
Yeah, yeah.
Right now, right?
Yeah, that's what the just bcl.american.edu. You can use MATLAB. Also, I think there's like Mindsweep, so it'd be really good. We can chat more about the back channel discussion if you want to keep going on here. Sorry, that's I find that annoying when the mouse takes over. Scott Tallon actually uses Twitter a lot, and a lot of students will be on Twitter. I think it's 88% of college students are on Twitter right now. It might be different in your classes, but probably not that different. And that collates things by hashtags. The hashtag is anything with that pound sign, and you can pull up a website that's just dedicated to that pound sign. So Scott Tallon's class is at AUSMST, what his class, I guess, acronym is. And you can see what's happening, and you can either have it on a second screen or have it be an out-of-class assignment. So you ask students to, I think what he does is he mandates one tweet directly after class, so 140 characters, giving a summary of what class was about. And it's just kind of a check-in participation grade, and you can see where people are at. You can see that they really did not get it, or see who's really, I guess, coming out of their shell in social media versus in person. And I see these streams just continually keeping updated. The class was in the previous summer, and it was still happening last September and October. People just wanted to chat with each other. And it's a way for them to connect outside of class and kind of extend your classroom from your temporal space out into the ether.
What do you use if you really don't think anything terribly intelligent you said in 144 characters? 140 characters. If you think sophisticated discussion sometimes requires 200 or 250 characters.
Lots of people use Facebook because you can have as many as you want, or you can make a class blog. So whatever kind of suits your suits what you want. With social media, AU is currently working on a policy because there's a lot of concerns with privacy. One thing that I would recommend if you do come up with a student that is not interested in joining a social network is to use a nom de plume. And as long as it's a nom de plume or a different name for those, so they can say that you're just as long as they know that when I'm tweeting under John Smith, it's really Laura March, then that'll connect to whatever you're doing to grade or assess their work. Mm-hmm. Cool. So you've been seeing poll everywhere, but I wanted to show you more of what how else it can be used.
So you're giving a presentation, and you want to get some feedback from your audience. Show of hands, how many of you have signed up for office hours? 1, 2, 4, 2, 5. That's not very accurate. Old voting methods take far too long, and expensive voting systems like this one, well, they're difficult to set up and don't allow for audience comments. Hello? Introducing Poll Everywhere. Through a simple web interface, Poll Everywhere lets you collect instant audience feedback. Just type in a question, and your audience can respond using laptops, tablets, or even mobile phones, even your crappy flip phone. Hey guys, what do you think of my presentation so far? Is it A, amazing, B, incredibly amazing, or C, not that great? To respond, just text message the number on screen. Or use a custom URL to respond in the web app. You can even use Twitter if that's what you're into. As people respond, results are embedded instantly into your presentation in real time. Seriously, guys? You can also ask open-ended questions. What is your favorite part of my outfit?
That's easy.
Poll Everywhere also lets you customize the look of your charts to wow your audience. And for all you spreadsheet nerds out there, you can even create segmented cross-tab analytics.
The best part about it is you can try it today for free. So how excited are you guys about Poll Everywhere? A, can't contain it, or B, not at all? Kaboom! Instant audience feedback. Poll Everywhere.
Was there anything else that we should go over with, oh, so yeah, 40 respondents on free version and 65 for 250 respondents.
So is that at the time?
At the
time. So if I have two class sections of 35 each.
Then you're A-OK.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Anything else that you want to go over with the Poll Everywhere or more back channel discussion issues?
I have a general question.
Mm-hmm.
I've been teaching for a couple of years, and most universities use Blackboard, and some of the stuff is pretty standardized. Many of my students have already using Google Docs or their group assignment. I'm just curious if, since there isn't a standard for any of these,
mm-hmm.
and maybe that's a good thing. I'm not disparaging
mm-hmm.
saying that. I'm just curious if anybody has used these, if students get sort of overloaded, and they think, well, I've got Blackboard, and I've got Facebook, and I've got Twitter, and I've got Poll Everywhere, and I've got a bunch of other things, many of which look very useful. Does anybody, or is there any literature, is any thought about how all these different things are working, or is it too early to tell?
The feedback that I've gotten is being a little bit lenient. So if one professor wants all their students to submit their assignments via email, they shouldn't penalize them if they submitted it by Blackboard, at least the first time around, until they know different. But beyond that, it seems people are used to having that many logins and passwords, and it's native for people that have been growing up with smartphones. But really it's just about making sure that there's more of a community of practice, so everybody's a-okay with letting some leniency happen here and there, and not to get too caught up in the details. Yeah.
And then most thing that seems to be bothersome for adoption is whether if it doesn't seem deliberate, right? Because that's students, in my experience, don't have a problem using it as long as you see, like, oh, it actually fulfills the purpose, and it actually makes sense in the context of using it. It's actually adding something, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, if say that you have a course blog and you want people to blog, right? But you say, like, oh, you should just blog at least 5 times during the semester, then you will get much worse blog results, and if you give like specific prompts and they're graded, a part of the assessment, you know what I mean? So it really depends. You can have multiple platforms, and as long as they're deliberately incorporated in a smart way that makes sense for students and that motivates students to use it, then they will be using it, regardless of how many they have.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not really about the sort of the amount of platforms as much as how well they're incorporated.
Mm-hmm.
That seems to be motivating, and will also show. Because sometimes people are sort of using things like, oh, I didn't get the participation I wanted in this particular platform, so I think it's pretty useful. But then when you ask students, like, no, the platform is fine, because they know how to use it, and they get the instructions to do their bit.
Right.
So,
that feedback loop almost. So if you're going to make students write tweets or Facebook posts or blog posts and never get back to them on it, they're going to hate it. And they do hate it, because especially with some of the pilot projects that we've done. Why are you making us blog and never telling us if we're doing it right? But other classes that blog, have it go seamlessly, and it's a really enriching experience because they're able to craft content for the web and go to a future employer and say, I was able to have a blog that had 3,000 hits in 1 week. So it really just depends if you're willing to invest the time on that.
And we sit on the expertise to help out with that process, right? So CTRL definitely has enough experience to be able to sit down and say, okay, so this is what you're trying to get at. This is like approximately how you should craft it and incorporate it into the course to make sure that you get the buy-in that you want.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Are there links for Poll Everywhere similar to the Google app that talk about how to use Poll Everywhere in the classroom
mm-hmm.
in terms of tips and?
Oh yeah, definitely. Poll Everywhere might actually be one of the. Are we chatting about it all? Is a TRL event? I know iClickers was one of them last semester. I'll make sure that I add that to in the notes. Okay, everybody's favorite, memorization, flashcards. I actually got this from a graduate consultant last semester who used StudyBlue for virtual class cards. Has anybody used this in any of their classes or had their students? It's pretty cool, and a lot of people are using it now. It's free for both iOS and Android, but it's that freemium option where you can choose to buy add-ons. And one of those add-ons is being a teacher. I think that it is $5 to $14 for a teacher to get their teacher pack, and you can actually create the flashcards for your students and push them out. These are what the flashcards look like. This is, there are already, I think it was, let's see, 150 million student-authored flashcards right now, and anybody can make it even on the free version, and anybody can access those public flashcards. You can set to whether your flashcards are public or private, and you can write text, including those kind of complex equations, upload images, and record audio as your flashcards. So maybe if it's something with pronunciation in world languages, or if you need to be able to do an oral exam for something and give that audio feedback. And you can also set daily reminders. As an instructor, you can create those flashcards, but I also think that kind of creating the flashcards is part of the student experience for setting themselves. But you can also go in and see your students' progress on the flashcards. So if they've gotten through all 100 of your flashcards or not, how many they've gotten wrong, how many times they've tried it, you can keep tabs on their study skills, which is important, I guess, to modify before the actual exam happens. Anybody use any other types of virtual flashcards yet?
Quizlet.
Quizlet? Yeah. I've heard that too. Mm-hmm.
Could you get the data to try and do not a formal study, but an informal study correlating use of the cards with grades or something like that?
Oh, definitely. If you signed up for that teacher pack and you saw how many students were doing it.
Right, but could you get like data like how often a student did it, how often they would write, things like that?
Yeah, they have all of that. And you'll be able to even check that against their final grades, too.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Mm-hmm. Cool. The last one that I have is a group communication tool called Remind 101. And I like it because of the privacy it affords instructors, that you don't necessarily have to give out your private phone number, but you can still text your students. And I thought it would be best to just show it, too, because I don't want to bug anybody with texting them right now.
Remind 101 provides a safe, free way for teachers to text message students and stay in touch with parents. Remind 101 is simple. Sign up and create a class. Tell your students and parents to subscribe. Then start sending messages. Remind 101 is safe. Teachers never give out their personal phone numbers, and they don't have access to the numbers of their students or parents. It's one way only. Plus, message history can never be deleted. Remind 101 is built for teachers. Field trip reminders, motivational messages, homework or exam reminders, and more. Extending your classroom has never been easier. To get started, go to remind101.com or download the iPhone or Android apps. Safe, simple, free. That's Remind 101.
So I'm hoping that one of the new Blackboard updates would be that you can sign up and get text messages, but until that happens, students are looking at their phones, not necessarily their emails, and it's great to have that extra reminder in there if it's something, if enhancing study skills and personal time management isn't part of your course objectives, then to just figure out what's best.
You just touched on something I was wondering about, sort of listening to all of this. We're all of the generation that email is the primary method of communication. Students are apparently less connected to email and just more connected to what?
Mm-hmm. It's text messages.
Text messages, mm-hmm. Okay.
It's I think it's only 68% of students check their email every day. Yeah. It's way
more
out
of
my right? Especially when you're asking your students to check their email every day for any updates, they're not. They're just not. So what they would do...
Is there an age range? So if I deal with grad students versus undergrad,
yeah,
you get a sense of...
Should be your email.
Are they still emailers, or are they more texters now, too?
It feels like everybody will answer a text or be aware of a text, but only people that are working in offices will immediately respond to emails. And there's just a study. The only reason I know this is because I was reading up on a study. I think it's Pew Research.
Are students allowed to, respond all? Mm-hmm. If I would send out something, I wouldn't want...
Right, they don't get to respond on this one. There are other ones that you can do that. I think it's GroupMe. Is that one that you guys use?
GroupMe and WhatsApp.
And WhatsApp, that you can do the reply all, or like do those more group ones. But this is just a one way sending it to you.
Mm-hmm. So if I get that on my iPad, they then go to the website and sign up.
No. Well, they...
Do they have to download the app?
No, they don't have to do anything, actually, beyond that texting. So once you sign up with your name and your course number, you'll get a number like this. And then you just tell your students to send a text to that number, which is a fake number, it's not yours, with the message at com or whatever you choose to be your customized message. And then the phone will be signed up to automatically receive text.
Okay, but I will never know their number.
Right.
So we're...
Can you tell who's signed up and who's not?
I think you can tell the number of who signed up. So you can tell that you had 67 people sign up.
Okay.
Yeah. And so the reason that this was first of all for like K-12 is so that you could have all the parents sign up that way too, but then you wouldn't get any of their responses sent back.
Does it have a website?
Yes.
So that I could do it from the website as opposed to...
That's Remind 101. And then on the website and in the app itself, too, you can set future dates. So if you don't want to wake up at 8:30 in the morning to remind people to come to a 9 o'clock class, you can set that months in advance.
The one hopes I would be up by...
One hopes. Depends how close you live to Tommy Town, right? Or if you wanted to do something like if you had a paper due at midnight and you wanted to make sure that a reminder was sent out at 11, you can set those far in advance. And that's all through the remind101.com, too.
Snooze.
There you go.
Yeah.
Well, that's it for me and the apps that I found today. Again, we have this mobile learning initiative, and I would love if you signed up and I'll shoot you the form to give some reviews on the apps that you're already using or the apps that you really hated. We need both of those. And sign up right there. Lucas Wegner is in the back that can help you get some funding or help with whatever you'd like to use. And thank you again so much for coming. Come on up, yeah.
I have a general question.
Sure.
You mentioned that there's going to be a major board upgrade.
Mm-hmm.
I know that's not maybe directly related to this, but do you know how we find out what's going to be in there? I'd be very curious to see what integration
sure.
if any.
You can contact the library Blackboard office, which is blackboard@american.edu.
Okay.
And hopefully it'll happen over winter break. They said that they were going to do it this summer, but it didn't happen.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Anything else? Oh, do I have to do evaluation?
You don't have to do it.
Okay.
I'll be collecting evaluations.
Wonderful. Well, thank you all so much. And
thank
come
you.
Play with this stuff if you'd
you
like.
You're
going to
make me a piece of paper from down
below? I'll email everything I'm
not
sure.
I'll make
it to you now. Right.